quality mandate in higher education. Now, aiming to improve the quality in higher education institutions, the University Grants Commission has adopted the Higher Education Quality Improvement Program mandate. Five articles of quality mandate developed by UGC cover evaluation reforms, eco-friendly and sustainable university campuses, human values and professional ethics, faculty induction and academic research integrity. So how will these five verticals contribute to improving the quality of higher education in our country? To understand this and analyze it further, we have a distinguished panel of guests today with us. Let me first introduce the guests to you, beginning with Professor V. Ramgopal Rao, Director, Indian Institute of Technology, Delhi. We also have with us Ms. Renu Batra, Additional Secretary, University Grants Commission. And we are also joined by Professor Anu Singh Lata. She is Vice Chancellor, Ambedkar University in Delhi. Welcome all of you to Rajya Sabha TV. Let me begin with you, Ms. Batra, to try and understand a bit more about these five verticals and the concept of quality mandate for higher education.
As you know, UNESCO has issued the quality sustainable development goals, which are 17 in number. And at number 4 is the quality in higher education. And India is one of the signatory of the UNESCO SDGs. So keeping that in view, the quality in higher education, UGC in the month of May 2018 has come out with a quality mandate. And this quality mandate has 5 objectives with the 10 verticals. Objectives are that what we are going to achieve and how we are going to achieve, that is, we have mentioned in our verticals, that is a program of action, what we are going to do with that.
Okay.
And that quality mandate and objectives and verticals were approved by the commission. And we had a meeting of all the vice chancellors of all over the India, and even the directors of various institutions also participated in that workshop, where this quality mandate was discussed, deliberated and adopted by the institutions. So taking that matter further, we have come out with various programs. And 3 or 4 programs are Diksha Aram program, which we launched last year. Then there is a program of Pramarsh. Diksha Aram program is meant for the student induction program. When the student come to any institution, so their entry into the institution should be more comfortable and acceptable. They should know about the ethos of the institution. They should know about all the activities or the program of the institution. So we have developed a Diksha Aram student induction program, which is for the 6 days. Mm-hmm. And for that, we have trained around 1,000 teachers, and around 500 institutions has implemented the student induction program.
Okay.
And we have got a very good feedback from the students that it was a program which was very much required for the students.
Mm-hmm.
Another program which we already has launched is the Paramarsh program. As you know, NAC is the agency which is accrediting the higher education institutions. So we have kept a target that by 2022, all the higher education institutions should be accredited by the NAC. Now, in our country, a lot of diversity is there, different type of the institutions are there. So we thought that there are some good institutions which can mentor the institution so that they should be ready to go for the accreditation.
Okay.
So we have identified around 167 institutions which are more than 3.5 OGPA by the NAC accreditation. And these institutions will be doing the mentee for the 900 plus institutions.
Mm-hmm.
So with this, we would like to improve the culture of accreditation among those institutions. We would like that institutions should be ready and they should get at least 2.5 of the NAC accreditation grading by the NAC.
Mm-hmm.
So these are the two programs which we have already started. Another program which we started is a STRIDE program, which is to promote the interdisciplinary research and multidisciplinary research. In that also, we have 3 components. Component 1 is for the capacity building. Component 2 is to undertake the research in all the program. And component 3 is basically for the human sciences, to undertake the high impact research.
Okay.
For that, we have entrusted this work to the Banaras Hindu University. So they are helping us in identification and the evaluation of the proposal. And under component 1, we have already identified 35 institutions which would be taking up the research further.
Okay. Now, adding to this are those 5 verticals which have been recently adopted. And if I'm reading them right from here, you know, evaluation reforms, then there is a SATAT, a framework for eco-friendly and sustainable campus. Then it's Mulya Pravaha, that's guideline for inculcation of human values. Guru Dakshita, that's a guide for faculty induction. And the last one, the most important one, the CAIR, Consortium for Academic and Research Ethics. So these are, how do you focus on these particular 5 aspects?
So these are the 5 programs which has been launched yesterday by the Honorable Minister of Human Resource Development. Basically, as you said, one is on the faculty induction program, that is Guru Dakshata. Mm-hmm. As you know, teachers play a very important role in any educational institution, be it a school education institution or a higher education institution. And we are doing lot of, we are facing lot of challenges, first to recruit the teachers, to retain the teachers. And if we are able to retain the teachers, how we should have to make them the role model teachers.
Okay.
And as of now, there is no formal training when the teacher go for the teaching in a higher education institution. So we have developed a program, Guru Dakshata, we call it as faculty induction program, which is a 1 month program. And in this 1 month program, there are 10 different modules.
Mm-hmm.
So any newly recruited teacher, when he or she join any higher education institution, they have to undergo this 1 month program, and in which 10 modules are covered.
Okay.
And this is mandatory, and this is as per the UGC regulations 2018, which we have issued for the appointment of the teachers and their eligibility condition and the pay scale.
Okay.
So this is a mandatory program for all the newly recruited
teachers. And before I go to Professor Rao and Professor Anu as well, one more aspect, that's the CAIR, Consortium for Academic and Research Ethics, because that's a very important area.
Yeah, that is very important. You are very right, because you must be listening, or you, everybody, so many newspapers and all that, they cover that the research which is not published is not in a good journal, it is a very dubious type of research, quality is not maintained, even at the international level it is being criticized. So how to take care of that? Mm-hmm. So we have come out with a very innovative sort of program, that is, we call it as a CARE, that Consortium for Academic Research and Integrity.
Mm-hmm.
In this program, what we have done is that we have constituted an empowered committee, and this empowered committee comprised of the representative from all the regulatory authorities, be it ICAR, ICMR, ICSSR, ICPR, ICHR, all the regulatory authorities,
all
the various fields. We have to see what are the journals, what are the good journals in which the teachers should be encouraged to do the publication, to publish their research articles in that.
Okay.
So for that, we have identified Pune as a nodal university. And we have also identified the 4 regional universities. One is in Tejpur, MS University Baroda, then University of Hyderabad and JNU. So what we have done is that we have identified, made a protocol how we have to do that. So this protocol has 3 components: basic information, protocol number 2, protocol number 3. So any public, any journal which we consider that it is a good journal, and any publication which is done by that any faculty working in any university, they would be considered as a good publication for their promotion and for their other evaluation system. So we call it as a CARE list.
Okay.
So this list has been published, and it is a dynamic list. We are not going to stop it once. It will help in quality of the publication. It will also give the morale to the teachers that they are able to publish in a good journals. It will also reduce that predatory journals which are being published by the publisher only for the sake of publication. So it will help in a very wider manner, that we will be able to bring the quality of research and integrity in the research. That
okay.
is the basic
okay.
idea.
So that's an apt summary or understanding of what exactly is the UGC's guidelines or the quality mandate we are talking about. Let's now go across to two of our panelists who head institutions. Professor Rao, from your perspective, this focus on both the faculty induction program, the research aspect of it, inculcating values, ensuring the campus is also, according to the sustainable development goals. How much would you agree to this in terms of the way it is being done and the guidelines out there to achieve those targets which we are looking at?
I think it looks good. I mean, these are things that we need to state, and we need to tell the universities to follow that. But it's all eventually a matter of implementation.
Mm-hmm.
How are we going to implement it? I think there are lots of rules. When you are driving, there are so many rules that you are supposed to follow and all that, but nobody really follows. I think it's all a matter of implementation. And at the end of the day, if you look at IITs, IIT Delhi, we are not really listing out all of these as rules, but there is a kind of a self-discipline and there is a peer pressure. So these are the 2 things which ensure that people are not able to do something, which you commonly see in other universities happening. I think that self-discipline, that peer pressure is what we need to build in our system. At IIT Delhi, for example, if you see a faculty member publishing a paper in a predatory kind of a journal, you know, I think it will be almost an end of the career. The end of the person's career, simply because, you know, the department will start to, you know, notice that. And when the person comes for promotions, out of 10 papers, if there are 2 papers which are in those predatory journals, there is no way the faculty member can get a promotion or anything like that. I think, you know, that is the kind of a the strict way we look at some of these papers. In fact, I tell faculty members, you know, by mistakes, sometimes what happens is they say, you know, I have published in that because some student who had gone away, you know, published it, put my name, I did not know, all of that. To those people I say, but you know, it's fine, somebody, you know, made a mistake, but you shouldn't even have shown it in your CV. You should have actually removed those papers. The fact that you were showing it to a committee only means that you really don't value about all of these. So that is the kind of a, you know, strictness with which we deal these things. And as a result, you know, we don't really see these problems right now.
Okay.
Once in a while, something might escape our radar, but overall, I think the quality is maintained, and you know, we are able to, you know, take things to that next level. I mean, the peer pressure is what drives the whole system.
Okay, let us bring in Professor Anu Singh Latur here. Professor Singh, you know, your view on all these quality mandate verticals, which Ms. Batra pointed out right now, but also the aspect, as Professor Rao is saying, that it's not only rules which will have to be implemented, but self-discipline also counts a lot here to ensure that quality is achieved for which all of us are striving here.
I completely agree with Professor Rao on what he spoke about the research and the research culture in IITs. But that culture may not exist in other disciplines such as social sciences, humanities, liberal arts and multi-faculty universities. The kind of professional ethics which is required in a higher education institution is generally missing. So once UGC has taken this as a mandate for the higher education institutions in the country, I think that's going to make hell of a difference by focusing completely on the professional ethics, I would say, more than the process involved. People who are into research, they actually need to understand what research is all about, what does it mean actually. So that's a $1 million question as to why are you doing research. The need for research, why am I doing research, is an important question before any teacher. I think the UGC has laid down, I have gone through the guidelines they have prescribed in their mandate and the documents and CARE, and the list they have provided. The list provided are of the journals which are scientific, which actually publish a good quality papers. So I think this is setting a tone and direction in the where the world is moving towards being more ethical in the research, more professional in doing researches.
Okay, so the tone and tenor has been set there as well. Ms. Batra, I'd like to bring you on one more aspect of these verticals here, an important one. That's the evaluation part, you know, bringing in evaluation reforms and, you know, this learning outcomes of that report of evaluation reforms in higher education institutions in India. So where does it point us to? And what kind of reforms are we looking at here?
In fact, as you know, our education system is that you go for the 3 years and reproduce whatever you have learned or whatever you have done, the roting system. So we would like to come out of the rote system. So first step, what we have done is that we have focused on the learning outcome based curriculum framework. What we are projecting is that any program, like suppose it is a BA program or the BCom program, any student who is joining this program, he or she should know what are the outcome after completing that program, what that student is going to achieve that. So in that particular program, what are the various courses which need to be taught, so that for each course also there would be learning outcome. So there would be alignment between the learning outcome of the course and learning outcome of the program. So once that is ready, then we will try to evaluate the students, whether the student has really acquired those competences or not, So this cannot be done by taking the examination once in a semester or this thing. So what the, we constituted a committee under the chairmanship of Professor M.M. Salunke, who was the Vice Chancellor of Central University of Rajasthan and few another universities. So we have come out with the recommendations that our examination system should be focused on the internal evaluation, where we can also evaluate the students' other attributes other than the knowledge, like whether the students have the scientific reasoning, whether students have ability for the communication, writing skills, and whether the student is able to have the have developed the cognitive skills, whether student has the leadership qualities, whether student can work in a team, like other abilities also which the student has acquired while doing that particular course is need to be assessed. So we have come out with this evaluation reforms. So in addition to the internal evaluation, we have also said ki it could be, I mean, we have given certain ratio, like in certain university right now it is 70% of the external evaluation, 30%. So we have said ki slowly and gradually you can move to 50-50% or 40-60%. So that depend on the institution to institution.
Okay.
Another thing what we have recommended is use of the ICT, technology based. That also need to be done, because then also there could be a lot of transparency in the system. That also has been recommended.
Okay.
Then also we have said about the moderation, also we have said about question bank, also committee has made certain recommendation. And for this purpose also we have conducted training of the controller of examination and dean academics, and around 700 controller of examination has been trained on our this particular report. So we are looking forward that the institution should start working on this next academic session, or slowly and gradually they have to come out of that rote system of examination to this type of system of evaluation.
Okay, let's again go back to both the professors here, and let's find out. And Professor Anu, I'd like to come to you first. In terms of the evaluation reforms aspect here, do you agree that focus on internal evaluation has to be a bit more than what it is right now? Gradually we should move towards, as Ms. Batra is pointing out, from maybe 20% or 30% towards 50-50 each.
I absolutely agree with her. In fact, all the professional programs which have been existing even before UGC has mandated this for all other programs, professional programs have already been having this kind of evaluation system, where the continuous evaluation which forms the integral part of the course delivery, and the program outcomes, the program specific outcomes and the course outcomes, and the program outcomes are linked to each and every step of evaluation. 60-40, 75-25, 50-50 is however the most of the universities are looking at. Continuous evaluation also gives a very comprehensive outcome of behavioral outcome of a student. Mm-hmm. When we say behavioral outcome, it also means that whether the student has walked away with a degree or he has really been a human being who has learned something out of the institution and taken takeaway in form of the behavior. For example, cognition would be the knowledge part, cognition would be the action part, and affection would be the sensitivity and the responsibility and ethics part of the education. Mm-hmm. So this continuous evaluation will help the instructor and the teachers to find out whether the behavioral outcome which has come out of the learning of a particular course in a particular program has really been achieved in terms of a holistic framework. Mm-hmm. And he has not just taken a degree by passing a few questions and attempting few questions at the end of the program. So this really, I endorse the idea of UGC that continuous evaluation should be integral part of the higher education system.
Okay, Professor Rao, does it work the same way in the science field, specifically when you're talking about specialized aspects and institutions like IITs?
No, we do have a continuous evaluation we follow the semester system. Mm-hmm. After about a month after a student comes, our minor starts, and then we have one more exam, and then there is a final exam. In between there are many assignments that the students need to do. There are many of them which they need to do in the class, some of them which they need to do as a take home kind of examinations. I think I compliment UGC for doing this, the continuous kind of an evaluation is very important for the students. Otherwise, you know, you keep on, you know, accumulating all the things and you spill it out, you know, at the end of the year, right? That's not going to actually work for any student, and this is a good process.
Okay, one more important aspect, since we are nearing the end of this particular show, the kind of guidelines which are there, the quality mandate which Ms. Patra mentioned, and it is there on the UGC's website, and institutions keep on getting from time to time several aspects which UGC develops further. But as the head of an institution, a scientific institution, and a good institute like Indian Institute of Technology Delhi, what is your perspective, or from your point of view, what is it that needs to be done more to, you know, have that quality or achieve that quality which we are looking forward to?
I think for everything, I think codification is the first step, which I compliment UGC for listing out what they need to do. Mm-hmm. I think implementation is going to be a very key aspect. You know, if I were to do something now to send that message that the publishing in predatory journals is not acceptable, I would start with the leadership. Just look at the vice chancellors of our universities in the country and see how many of them have published papers in those sort of journals to reach that position. Mm-hmm. Because that happens all over many times, and you know, it's actually a practice right now. And because the committees which are also selecting them, all of that, you know, tend to overlook that aspect of it. Clean up the system. Now start with the vice chancellors of universities. If they have, you know, 30% of papers in predatory journals, let there be an action taken on them. That sends the right message to faculty who are in the universities, and then, you know, that percolates down, and, you know, things will get cleaned up. Okay. I think we need to do a top-down kind of an approach, right?
Okay, so top-down kind of approach, and apart from codification, implementation will be a very important aspect. I'd like to bring in Professor Anu here as well. Professor Anu, your suggestions on what more needs to be done, or in a particular way that these particular guidelines needs to be implemented?
I feel that we have set the tone in the right direction, and as Professor Rao rightly pointed out, it needs to stop from the professional ethics coming from the top man. I think the journey has begun where we started focusing on the same, and when I look at the publication and the way research scholars and my own research scholars have started believing that they need to publish in the right kind of journal. So this has already started, and the culture needs to percolate down to the student right, who is also doing his MPhil and is doing his master's dissertation work, where he needs to believe that research is a serious work and it has to be taken professionally and in a more ethical manner. I think every work which is produced by even a master's student, master's dissertation work, should also be getting the right kind of focus. So the journey has begun. I think we need to create the culture and ensure the right implementation of all this. And I think we'll be able to meet our targets very soon.
Okay, Ms. Batra, you agree that the journey has begun, it has begun in a right way and right earnest, but yes. The top-down approach, as both of them are suggesting?
Yeah, I do agree with Professor Rao and Professor Anu. Actually, the care list which we have now published, at least it has brought the awareness among the teachers and the students that they have to make the publication in a right type of journals. Once the awareness is there, as Professor Rao has suggested, that slowly and gradually it will become a self-discipline. Then there would be no need for any care list and all that. Then when everybody is a self-discipline. And we have also mentioned that even if you publish, as Dr. Rao has said, when they go to the selection committee should be able to differentiate whether they are the good journals or they are not the good journals. So that also there is a level of filtration where they can do. I think if we all of us, starting from the top to the lowest teacher or the assistant professor or research scholar, if they all agree with all those things and they start working on improving the teaching learning processes, evaluation, bringing the ethics and professional ethics in the institution itself, and doing the research of the integrity, that will help in the bringing the quality in higher education. And we would be able to attain that sustainable development goal for which the target is 2030.
Okay, so there it is for our viewers. The gist of a quality mandate in higher education, the guidelines and how they need to be implemented, starting with a top-down approach, with a focus not only on the research aspect, but also faculty in